So, hi everybody. The next talk after the lunch is about Lucene, but it's not really something that's solely useful for Lucene. So everybody here inside having other maybe open source projects would also be invited to do similar stuff, because this one is, we have heard a talk yesterday already about by David Weiss about the randomized testing, and this is just showing the other parts of the Lucene build infrastructure, which we are using behind the scenes to make the releases of Lucene and Solr and also Elasticsearch, of the quality that that they are currently. So we detect bugs early. We find when somebody commits some code, that we already catch a lot of bugs before we release the whole thing. So before I start to talk about that, I wanted to give a short introduction about myself. I'm since about 2009, I'm committer of the Apache Lucene project. A little bit later, I got PMC chair. And since last year, I'm the chair of the Lucene project and also Solr. I originally did, you all know that maybe from Elasticsearch or Solr, that you can do numeric queries on Lucene. So that means you can do something like bounding box queries. And this was originally what I wrote back at that time. And it's still used in that way because it introduces something like numeric queries to an inverted index. I was also involved together with Michael Busch before in the new attribute-based text analysis API. And in real life, I'm working as a consultant for various companies, and we have our own company called SD Data Solutions, and I'm also maintaining a database of geoscientific data, and this is why the numeric queries came to Lucene. Yeah, the agenda today is, the first is the motivation, why we need all those additional testing we are doing in Lucene. In the second part, I will show the Lucene infrastructure, how everything works around that. And after that, the tools. One separate part, this is also part of the tools, is Policeman Jenkins. You know, maybe everybody, I'm also called the policeman. So this is just a tool that does the stuff on behalf of me. And as a final step, the automated release testing. So that's all goes around testing, so it should be quite interesting. So first, the motivation. Something changed in Lucene during the last 2 years. So in the past, we had something like maybe one release every year or something like that. It was really seldom before Lucene 2.9 or 3.0. So the problem was it took very long time until the new features came out to the user. And because of that, we also changed to do something which is quite common, to release our new features early and release them more often. The problem with that is, of course, we more often break backwards compatibility now because we cannot always wait for a new major version. But I think most people have arranged with that. And because of sister projects, so in the early days, Solr was also a sister project, but now we have Elasticsearch as a completely separate project. Those projects are very active, especially Elasticsearch, and they also share a lot of committers. So a lot of Lucene committers are involved in Elasticsearch and all the other way around. And because of that, we get a lot of new features or improvements in Lucene that need to be included into a new release so the other project can use that. And that's one reason why we have so many releases. I think 4.0 was released at the end of 2012, and now we are already at 4.8. And this is something like 10, 11, or 12 releases, but we had some bug fix releases in between. So you see, we are releasing more often now. The problem with that is, of course, there's a major burden for the release manager because the list of details we have before we can release the artifacts on the Apache servers and on Maven Central, there are many details. There's a wiki page about that, and that if somebody searches for a release to do, this list is very, very long, so there's a lot of stuff to do. Some of them is also related to how to do releases at Apache at all, but there's also a lot of quality checking. And the problem is a lot of these tasks to be done there can also be automated because in that case it's a hard failure. And the better thing is you would also catch those problems directly while doing the builds every night on Jenkins. Yeah, and the problems is of course they are time intensive. So, and this is how the release manager then looks like if he has to do all the tasks. And because of that, we have a better infrastructure to do that. So, the first about Lucene is, some people are always complaining about that, but it is how it is, and I will also give some explanation why it is like that. So, we are using Apache Arndt to build our releases, so there is For the official release building, there's no Maven involved at all. So, but we are still using Maven somehow through Apache Ivy, which is used for the dependencies to fetch all of them. We have in Lucene a multi-module structure, so Robert Mir showed that in the previous talk, that the download is now consisting of a lot of modules. Every module has a separate char file. So this is almost working like Maven internally, but there are many more features involved. And the only thing that's not yet working so good is the intermodule dependencies. So if somebody tries to build the Java docs on the Solar part, it takes days. No. Yeah, it takes something like 10 or 15 minutes until the Java docs are built, which is because it's sometimes some Java docs are built over and over again. We have to improve that. But why not use Apache Maven? This is also something a lot of the original committers don't like Maven. Some of them really hate Maven. I don't know, for a lot of projects, I also use Maven privately, but for Lucene, yeah, it's one reason, but another reason is we have a lot of more flexibility with Arndt because you can completely model your build. So it's not conventional build; it's a little bit more sophisticated. And you know, Maven is all about not about having special cases. Of course, you could call Arndt from Maven, but that's a reason. So I will start now with the tools we are using. A lot of those tools can also be used by other projects, so be free to use them. And I will start with one first tool, which is about static code analysis. So my first question is, what's, for example, wrong with the first code part on the top left? Does anybody know? What's wrong with that? Okay, I think most people already know that. Who is using Lucene and who is involved in Lucene? Okay, yeah, so, yeah, that's right. There's not the local involved, and especially that example will definitely do the wrong thing if you execute it in Turkey, for example, because if you have in Turkey something like the big I and you lowercase it, it gets a small I without a dot on top, and because of that, this is the worst you can do in your code is if you have some code in a library that you depend on the locale of the computer, so you have to be explicit. And that's one of the problems. Otherwise, this is a very funny article. I'm not really sure if this is really true, but that's quite funny to read. So a cell phone's missing dot kills two people and puts three more in jail. So this is all about this localization problem with a dotless E, which always hurts you. So that's a standard case, you have something like a hash map and you want the keys in the hash map to be lowercased to have the lookup case insensitive. But if you simply lowercase what comes in from the user, you would of course not hit that because of that problem, because for example, the lowercasing works different. This is one of that. The other ones are also quite clear. You might know the second one is also locale dependent. So not everything in Java is a Gregorian calendar. The Thai locale is very strange. It has a completely different calendar. So when you try to format a date in ISO format with a Thai locale, there would not be come out what you think expect about it. The lowest one is new input stream reader. You might also know what the problem here is. Does anybody know? Encoding, exactly. There the encoding is missing and it uses the default encoding on your system, which is on Linux, gladfully in most cases UTF-8, but on Windows it's something Windows 1252 or something like that. So if you're reading something like resource files from your char file and you don't specify the encoding, it can be that on specific systems this will not work. And the most horrible thing at all is, and this is why I hate Eclipse. No, I use Eclipse, of course, but this is the most horrible thing is this auto-generated catch block, which is enabled by default in Eclipse, or it was very long time enabled by default, because this one is the most biggest bullshit I have ever seen, to just catch an exception and as a default handler add a struct trace. So the correct way to do that is to bubble the exception up. So, but that's just my personal opinion, but all the other Lucene committers are sharing the same. So, but you see that quite often. Just try to enter Eclipse auto-generated into Google and you will see tons of pages doing that. So yeah, and our problem with that is we want to prevent that from happening in Lucene at all, because Lucene is very local sensitive and it's a library, and libraries should never depend on any defaults on the operating system, because that's for the user of the library to decide which locale he's using. So Lucene should not internally automatically use something like Thai calendar just because it's the default on the operating system. Especially if you have something like Solr or Elasticsearch, which runs on the server, and the server, of course, does never have this locale the actual user in his browser has. So it makes no sense to have something like that, except in conventional GUI applications that uses something like a default locale in server applications. So because of that, we tried a lot of stuff to do that, but at some place, Robert and I decided, yeah, we need some hard check for that. We must fail the build if somebody uses one of these horrible methods. There's a list on the blog post about this. And actually what we wanted to do, because it's not only limited to all that stuff, there's other things we don't want to have, like Lucene code node should never print anything out to system out or system error, like the print stack trace you have seen before. Or another thing is which makes test debugging, especially in a multi-threaded environment like Lucene, horrible, is if you spawn a thread without a name, because after that you only have something like a number of the thread and you cannot you have no idea to which the thread belongs. So there are a lot of stuff we simply said we don't want that any of the Lucene code calls any of those methods, and because of that we needed some check to do that. And the first question, of course, that comes is why don't we use PMD and findbugs for that? Yeah, you could use PMD and findbugs for that, but the biggest problem is this first thing is it's incomplete. The second thing is it does a lot of more static analysis, especially it also fails to build on stuff we are not interested in, so it's very hard to configure. And the other problem is it's working on the source code. Parts of it is working on the source code, so it's very slow. It slows down the build. And the biggest problem for us is, as I said, with unnamed threads or something like that, it's very hard to add something like custom signatures to that. And because of that, we created a simple tool that analyzes the bytecode produced after the compiler and checks it against a list of signatures. And then can optionally fail the build. It's also possible, for example, to disallow anything that's not in the official JDK of Java. So if you have any code, you don't need to explicitly say forbid sunmisc unsafe. It's automatically done because it's not in the official package list of Java. So it's impossible to use that method in Lucene. So you cannot get an unsafe. You can use it, but only through reflection. But then you have some proper error handling about that. But you cannot simply import that class. Yeah, the new thing is this tool is already available on Maven Central, and it's also compatible to Java 8. So it also works with every code Java 8 emits, like lambdas and all that stuff. It's not only used at the moment by Lucene. It's also used by Elasticsearch through Maven in that case. So, and because of that, you see it's available through Maven Central. You can use it as an unplugin. You can use it as a Maven Mojo. And it already ships with a lot of signature files included, like the ones you have seen before, the unsafe ones, missing character sets and all that stuff, locale, default locale. There are also signature files with the JDK deprecated signatures. Those were generated just from the official Java release. So we don't want to call any deprecated methods anymore in Java, and the problem is you can also force a compiler to complain about that, but the problem is if you're a library on your own, you also deprecate your own code sometimes, but you need to call it, and then you cannot fail on it. So in that case, we just want to fail on deprecated methods called from something in the JDK. So there's a lot of stuff included. I think it's maybe hard to read, but you can include it into your ANT build. It's described on the website. You can also use it from Maven. It's used already in a lot of more projects, not only Lucene, because it also has a possibility. So, for example, Elasticsearch is using it with Maven to not allow to release the whole Elasticsearch project if a test is failed with something like an evades fix or ignore annotation, for example. If that is in the test, you cannot release the whole project, so you have to fix the test first. And you can download the whole thing through Maven Central and get more information of that page. So this is one of the code we have free for everybody already. There's another problem we have, especially at the Apache Software Foundation. We are doing through the releases. You know, you see the tag cloud with a lot of crazy licenses. And the problem is you cannot use code from any license that's around there. That's very often a problem if we import custom analyzers for specific languages, which are in crazy stuff. So there's important things like shipping with the license file and all that stuff. So we have some special license checker, which is also written as an ANT task in Java. It's not yet public available because it's a little bit Lucene specific. But a side effect of the whole thing is because we are downloading now a lot of artifacts from Maven, and we ship them together with our distribution, the binary one, we also want to make sure that what we ship with the user are the original artifacts from Maven. So what we do is we have in our checkout all the SHA-1 checksums of all char files which are used and downloaded by Maven, but we check them before we build the release that all of them that were downloaded during the build process have the official checksums, for example. This is only a side effect of the whole thing, and then, of course, we are using Apache Red for checking that all source code has license headers and all that stuff.
Another thing that improved a lot in Lucene is about the Java docs. Because of a library, you need a lot of good documentation. So in earlier Lucene versions, there was a lot of stuff missing. So there was something completely missing Java docs for several public methods and all this stuff. So we wanted to make sure that the Java docs are readable. That does not, of course, enforce somehow that the Java docs are complete and helpful to the user. That's another problem about writing Java docs. But at least there should be some documentation that you are able to use the classes. And for that, we have also some tool available to make to force the programmer after committing that everything is all right. So the first thing is in parallel to the official Java C build, we are also switching for a short time in the ANT build and run the whole build process through the Eclipse compiler, because that one can fail on missing and incomplete and incorrect Java docs. So this one is downloaded via Ivy, then executed on the whole build tree, but it does not produce char files or class files at all. It's just there to simply check that all source code has Java docs that are valid after that. And we also have a second part, which is a Python script running on the build servers that checks, for example, that all the links are pointing to somewhere, because you know the problem, you're deleting a method from some class, but you forget to have in another class to remove the link to that method, or the C other or whatever. And this is not everything. Everything is also catched by Eclipse's compiler. So especially when you have inter-module dependencies. So we have something when we build the whole Java doc and all the documentation as HTML output, there's some final check using HTML tidy and all that stuff to make the Java docs. Good. There's also something which is on the to-do list. You might already have known, or you might have been annoyed about that. There's a new feature in Java 8 to do the same like the Eclipse compiler, but it's a little bit more picky than that one. And the problem is it's enabled by default. So when you, I tried something like 5 out of 10 open source projects don't create Java docs with Java 8 because of that problem, because it fails hard on Java docs if you don't disable that one. So at the moment, we want to make use of that. But the problem is Java docs must be HTML4 and not XHTML. So it's not allowed to have this br with a slash at the end. So we have a lot of those in the Lucene code. So we have to clean that up first. So at the moment, if ANT detects that you are building Lucene with Java 8, it passes this magic parameter to the Java docs build. So I think this is already cloned in millions of other Java-related projects, though that's unfortunately, but I think this is one of those mega commits. Mike, we should do maybe something to fix that. So this one is about Java docs. Then there's another one. I have seen this quite often on Maven projects. So you started the build process, then you did something like running the tests. And after that, if you run SVN status, it reports you that there are some folders or extra files in your working copy, which are outside of the official build directory. It's just in the working directory. So we want to prevent that something like that gets committed. So we want to check that after running tests and after running the whole build system, that the SVN working copy is in a good state. And we do that also on the Jenkins server in pre-commit checks. We also have, you might have seen the randomized testing yesterday. So we also have a little bit more in our test environment. So all the tests in Lucene are running with a security manager enabled, which completely forbids writing to files outside of the official test running working directory. So this is no longer really a problem. But in the earlier times, we had that especially Solar tests were creating Solar code cores inside the source directory of the source code, and the risk of corrupting the source code by that is very high. So because of that, we enabled that. This is no longer possible. I'm glad about that. So we are checking at the end of the build on Jenkins that the SVN is in a clean state. And we are currently doing that with a Groovy script inside the ANT build, which uses SVN kit. You cannot do that with the SVN command line alone, because it's very hard to do all the checks we are doing, so it's just a short script. And if you are doing something like that, and you are on Jenkins, and you run your build, and you have something like that, you see this is the exact same example. The build fails after that. So this is one you should really think about. You can do the same, of course, with GitHub. So checking if you just need maybe another Java library, I have not looked into that. So this is also very custom to Lucene, but it's only 15 lines of Groovy code in the Jenkins in the ANT build. This, as I said, we don't use Maven, but Lucene still supports Maven. So it's also possible to build the whole of Lucene with Maven, but without all additional checks. But this is maybe a good idea if you want to quickly look into it, or maybe want to load it in your Eclipse or whatever. So we have a Maven build available, but you have to ask ANT to generate the Maven project files for you. Those project files are also used to deploy the artifacts later. And those POM files are generated by an additional ANT task, which uses the ivconfig files to produce the Maven dependencies. There's one speciality in Lucene. Nobody of us want to have transitive dependencies. You know, Maven is sometimes trying to download the whole internet, and we don't want to have that, but there's no possibility to disable that easily in Maven. So in our Ivy build, we explicitly say we want to have that jar file, that jar file, that jar file. So it's not really dependency management. It's just a downloader for the jar files in our case. So we know exactly what we want to have. And when transforming that to the Maven build, we have to add a lot of excludes to prevent Maven from downloading the internet. Because if you run that standardly on Linux, it downloads something like half a gigabyte of stuff, which is totally unrelated to Lucene. Yeah. And finally, where do we run all these crazy tools? So there's one thing. We have several build servers at the Apache Software Foundation. But the problem we have is, as explained yesterday, during our test runnings, we have randomization almost everywhere. So Lucene changes while running the tests in a predictive manner. So when a test fails, you can repeat the test. It changes something like random codec settings. It uses different directory implementations to test all the code. It also changes, of course, the random locale and default char sets. If something breaks, you might have seen something not yet fixed or detected by forbidden APIs. And we also have random indexing data. But the whole thing is reproducible, because if you fail, if you have a text failure, you get the random seed in the test, in the stack traces, and you can repeat the test. So if you want to, if you would have time yesterday, you, I hope everybody of you was also in that talk, which was very nice to be informed about that. So how the Lucene test framework is also very, so Lucene is one of the, I think, one of the best tested open source projects. Yeah, I just say this, but I haven't seen any other open source project with so many tests and so many special cases covered by tests. So, but there's still one thing missing on the Jenkins one, and this is also quite famous in Lucene, because Lucene is working on so low level of the JDK, of the hotspot virtual machine, that we trigger a lot of bugs in the JDK. You might have heard about the first Java 7 problem when Java 7 came out and it crashed Porter Stemmer, so also the Eclipse help was crashing at that time. Just because of a bug in not in Lucene, but in the JDK, which was triggered by Lucene. And to prevent that in the future, a second time this happened last September, when update 40 of Java 7 came out. At that time, we had a second problem where on several CPUs, we had something like corrupt indexes after that. So currently, you might have read the release notes of 4.8. You must use update 7, update 55 at the moment, or you should use it. So we don't prevent it to run that. But the problem is, because the code is so low level and it's executing loops millions and millions and millions of times, so it's highly optimized. In the talk yesterday by David Weiss, he was showing something like the assembler output. So you have something which is three classes in executing a query, but everything is optimized in Hotspot into one big assembler method. And this assembler method also changes. So when you executed that 100 times after, it detects, I can improve that, and then it changes the code. And sometimes it happens that those optimizations simply produce wrong assembler code, and then we crash that. And so we need another randomization. We catch that bugs because of the randomization in our data we are using, but we also want to test different settings on the JDK. We want to exchange JDK versions. We want to find bugs, for example, in newer JDK versions. We are not yet have not yet really certified. So at the moment, I'm working on including Java 9 into the build system, which is not possible at the moment because of another bug we found already. So, and because of that, so as I said, we change a lot of stuff like garbage collector, bitness of the JVM, client or server VM, compressed ordinary object pointers. You might know in 64-bit JVMs, we have pointers which are only 32 bits to save space. But this makes sometimes guesses about the RAM usage of something wrong, so you have to test this. And of course, it has bugs. And of course, we want to change the platform, because Windows is very special, because you cannot delete files which are currently open. This makes a lot of tests sometimes fail. If they're working on Linux, you can delete the file. But on Windows, it's impossible to delete a file that's currently open. So you could, of course, define for every of those run a separate Jenkins job, which is something like hopeless, because you have to spawn something like 200 different Jenkins jobs. And if you update something, you have to change 200 Jenkins jobs. So you want to do that somehow also randomized. And this is what we are doing here. So we have something like a pseudo JDK entry in our Jenkins. And this one is not really exist, and it's there just as a placeholder. And we have some script which changes then during the Jenkins build the Java home and add some additional test JVM args which are used while running the tests. And this is done by a Groovy script running inside Jenkins. And it also does something, so when the build finished on Jenkins, it also adds this as a description to the build, so you can also look into, okay, this build failed, yeah, this was using that JVM with that that settings. So, and it also sends it in the email. So what we did is we added an extra JDK config, which is called random, which is just pointing to a dummy directory. And we use that for all builds that should be randomized. So it's not so good to see. So it's just a fake here. And then in the job config, we have the Groovy script called. And this one then sets all those variables. I think you can do the same with Maven builds, of course, too. If you don't use freestyle build, you can, of course, call any scripts to do that. I know Elasticsearch is doing the same on their Jenkins server. So what it does, it simply executes this Groovy script on starting on the node master. And after that, this is some extraction from the Groovy script. So we have here, it can be a little bit more optimized. It's just for information purposes. I think Elasticsearch now has something that completely shuffles everything around. This one has some supported configurations of Java 7, update 55. You also see we're testing Java 8, update 20 already, which comes out soon. And after that, it simply sets some environment variables. And we pass that to the ANT build. We set the build description. And after that, you're seeing this is the last Lucene build on Jenkins. So you see here some builds are failing, which is not caused by this randomization. It's some other reason, because Solr tests are sometimes a little bit unstable. But you see here on the left side, we have you see on every one which JDK configuration was used to do that, and because of that, you can then try to reproduce some problem, which is for hotspot bugs a lot more complicated. I've talked about that last year. Unfortunately, I don't have time for that. So the build looks like that. It simply reports at the beginning everything that was used. So that's just a randomization, so you get every information. And my final thing is about about the last thing shortly before the release, because of the burden to the release manager, we have some automated release testing. Currently, the workflow is the release manager creates the artifacts. He does some initial testing. Then the project management has 72 hours to vote on this. And then the artifacts are published together with the Java docs. And the release building is first doing all those checks we have seen before. Then we have a Python script wrote by Mike McCandles that creates and uploads all the files to the staging server. And it runs an interesting tool which is called Smoke Tester. So the Smoke Tester is also a Python tool running, and it does some additional tests at the end. So the first thing about this tool, it's Python powered, as said before. The second thing is it's convenient use for the release manager and the PMC. It also includes functional testing, of course. It takes approximately 1 hour. I'm not sure if you can see that. So, and the last one, it's important. In this 1 hour, it burns all your CPUs you have, so you cannot use your computer while running those tests. So on some computers, it also takes 2 hours. I have seen people doing it in 25 hours, 25 minutes, I think. So, yeah. And though smoke testing is done also nightly, so we are prepared that that the release is quite easy for the release manager. You can download the artifacts all day. Thank you. Three minutes, I think.
Hi. First, from the Hadoop team, we're impressed. Secondly, how do you do your blame assignment?
How do you what?
How do you assign blame when something doesn't work? What's your proof?
I don't understand it.
When one of your team breaks the build.
What we do then?
Yeah.
Yeah. It depends. So in most cases, the problem is we are running the tests 24/7 all the time. So it could be that you wake up in the morning, somebody committed something before going to bed, and then he goes to bed, and in the morning you have your whole email box full with failed builds. Yeah, we don't revert the commits automatically. That bad practice at the Apache Software Foundation. Also, if you revert builds of other people, you should not do that. So in most cases, we reopen the issue, or if it's easy to fix, like a forbidden API, somebody missed the locale, then it's then somebody else takes care and simply commits a quick fix for that. In most cases, it's just simple things you are just missing, because Eclipse auto-completes you if you're using string too lower. It suggests to you to use too lower case to come back to the example. So you see where the problem is, and in that case.
Okay, I think...
Yeah, fixing that in most cases to replace it.
I think you can maybe ask another question in more informal setting. Yeah. So thank you very much for your talk.